raised in the first talk. At the outset, I would like, I'm not sure how many people have read this book, but you know, we've been through Atul Gawande's Better, Complications and all those books that have followed. But this is one of the very, very good books that I've read recently, which I would want most of you to go back and read. It's an astronaut's guide to life on Earth, and he is an orthopedic surgeon, can very well relate to this author, Chris Hadfield, who is the longest, you know, the astronaut who has spent the longest amount of time in space. This basically, he tells, the gist of the book is that, what is the thing that is going to kill me next? You know, every moment in space or every space walk is basically, you know, fraught with dangers and problems. So similarly, when you are embarking on any surgery, all that you have learned all through your life, all that you have practiced all through your life is all brought together on the operating table at that moment. So this is exactly what he also tells, that this is what he has learned throughout his life training as an astronaut and being an astronaut. So let me begin with some good news at the, you know, outset, that this revision knee replacements are never, you know, for the faint-hearted, or they're always some, you know, give a lot of stress and sleepless nights to the surgeon. The good news is that we are getting better. You know, if you compare from the data from 1970s to 2000s, we are gradually getting better, and the risk of revisions is slowly going down. So what can we use to guide as to what are the problems that face us? This is a very good paper from Paresh Sadar in the Bone and Joint Journal. Very recently it was published. So it talks about the epidemiology of failure in total knee arthroplasty. It talks about all the joint registries that are existent, and it picks up very, very salient features regarding every aspect of knee replacement, right from infections to DVTs to loosening, to septic loosening, to the problems with implant. So what we got to answer, and you know, how we start PR planning, why PR planning in revision knees is slightly different to primary knees, is that we got to find out and define the cause, and that is the first step to plan and to execute this successful revision. You can divide the failures between early failures and late failures. Early failures are generally related to infections, primarily caused by the surgical procedure. Late failures are likely to be implant related. The other reasons for failures, or common reasons for failures, could be malpositioning, instability, patellofemoral issues, infections. Late failures could be aseptic loosening, periprosthetic fractures, again instabilities, and again infections. So basically, you want to look for certain factors which could have caused these particular problems, like, you know, not recreating the joint line properly, elevating or sort of depressing the joint line, ligament damage, ligament imbalance, or not creating the posterior condylar offset. So basically, as Heiko Greitchen described, there are basically three columns on which you can base your decision making. One is a thorough and a detailed history. When did the pain start? When does the pain come on? Was there any pain-free period following the surgery? Did the pain come after a few years? What brings on the pain? A detailed clinical examination right from the scars, the sinuses, the attitude of the limb, the ranges, the instability. At what degree does the instability manifest? Is the patient having some midflexion instability? Is there a problem coming downstairs or problem going upstairs? Getting proper x-rays, getting radiographic information is extremely important. You need to get a proper standing x-ray, one joint above, one joint below the standard norm. You need to get good long leg alignment films. And if required, your serological investigation and special radiological investigation to aid into finding out what went wrong. So at the end of this pre-op algorithm, the reason for the failure, you should have it very clear in your mind that this is probably what went wrong, and this is how I probably would need to address it. Just an example of a long leg film, we got these modern jigs and modern so you can see a standard long leg film, but there are these beads and markers on it. So we use the software, and we use a particular software which creates a three-dimensional anatomy and basically measures every possible sort of, you know, posterior slope, the condylar offset, everything to the last millimeter. Getting a long leg film is important because you can see that there is a periprosthetic fracture, but there is again an implant on the proximal end of the femur, which would come in the way of you doing your surgery or the revision. So you need accurate measurements. Most of us get the digital x-rays, which may not be true size, and therefore you may have to sort of, you know, use the tools which are available on the packs or electronic tools to measure the distances which are there, whether you can get your implants in the correct position, whether these implants or your devices are going to come in the way of you performing the surgery, and you need to have some alternate strategies as well. some special investigations like the PET CT or the bone scans can come in handy. As in this example, that you know, on the right hand side you can see that there is a spacer included, but the patient is still not better. So whether this joint is still hot, whether it is still infected, or the infection has cleared or no, you could make out not by simple X-rays and CBCSR, but also relying on these special investigations. The importance of proper X-rays cannot be highlighted any more than, you know, in the right hand side, if you see there is an improper X-ray, which could lead you to sort of, you know, having a false sense of security that everything is going on well and the implant looks well. But just an X-ray in a different alignment can show that there is a gross loosening of the femoral component. There is a sort of a lesion on the tibia. Even the patella looks a bit eaten. It goes in favor of an infected pathology because there you can see a lot of synovitis. So just by getting a better X-ray, you can sort of, you know, understand that a lot could go on. Then once you have seen these X-rays, you sort of try to sort of superimpose what the clinical picture intraoperatively could be. You know, a simple cyst or simple osteolysis could manifest as a massive bone loss intraoperatively, and you could be caught unawares. These bone losses are assessed preoperatively, but more often than not, they can be reclassified or reassessed intraoperatively, which you would see in the subsequent talks. So at the end of the retrieving the implant or taking out the implant, you could be left with a massive bone loss. And if you are surprised by finding an infection or some problem intraoperatively, you have to be prepared with alternate strategies. A few more questions you need to ask yourself is how to perform this joint. Now that you know the failure, now that you know what caused the failure, how to perform this, you know, sort of a redo knee surgery, where should I place the skin incision? Is the standard medial parapatellar approach good enough, or you need an extended approach? Are there any pre-existing implants that would come in my way? Has something else gone on? Are there any broken implants? Would I require some special jigs, special devices, or special sort of screwdrivers, osteotomes, or devices to remove these particular implants? These all have to be planned preoperatively. You would lose all the landmarks. So once these implants are out, more often than not, a lot of landmarks have changed. You generally struggle to find the landmarks. So there are well-defined sort of, you know, measurements from which you can sort of try and recreate the joint line. So these all landmarks, mind you, will be not there at the time of the surgery to guide you. Sometimes the intramedullary canal or the epicondyles may be there, but in case of bad periprosthetic fractures, you might not even get those landmarks. The challenges that you are going to face is basically problems of fixation and ligament balancing. So what do we have with us in our inventory to sort of, you know, tackle that? Is basically you should be prepared with a revision type of an implant, which gives you a special fixation options like stems, wedges, sleeves, and more constrained insert types if required. You know, when we were in England, they used to say, just get the kitchen sink, you know, order for the kitchen sink. So order for the kitchen sink is that you tell the representative to get everything that you have, but that doesn't help because what you are left with is more than 25 trays, more than 300 boxes of implant, and the staff doesn't know, your assistant doesn't know what is your plan A, plan B, and what is your fallback on. So it can lead to a lot of chaos. So, you know, reassess your goals. What you're going to achieve with this revision is a good alignment and stability with a good fixation, filling all the femoral, all the bone defects, and achieving good kinematics in the end. So you've got a lot of options to do that. And most of the implant companies, be it Zimmer, Depew, or Smith & Nephew, Stryker, they give you all options across the board, right from a simple sort of a femur, which is a posterior stabilized, to a constraint, to sort of a special femur. You get cemented, uncemented sort of femoral extensions or stems in various diameters and various lengths. You can have them to be in different offsets. You can have them to be in different sizes, with a collar, without collar. You can have different augments to, you know, fill in the distal femoral defect, the proximal tibial defect, the posterior sort of a posterior condyle. So there are a lot of, you know, mix and match that you can do with the components to achieve a better fit and to achieve a better contact with the native bone. The tibial trays again could be modular. You could have stems, wedges, augments along with that, which are different shapes, sizes. You could have metal sleeves. To address the ligament instability, you need to have a semi-constrained or a constrained liner or a constrained implant. But a lot of times you might not be able to balance the ligaments intraoperatively, or you might realize that it is very difficult to obtain. And that is when you realize that you need a rotating hinge. So if the collateral ligaments are deficient, then you are going to rely on the implant design to need for stability or for giving stability. So these are different special implants which have got slight design modifications than the primary implants, which give you adequate stability. So therefore, revision knees present multiple technical challenges, which and you need to restore your alignment, your bone stock, your joint line, your gap balancing, and these modular knee replacement systems with the various level of constraint and its stem and augments help you do that. So, you know, pay a lot of attention on your pre-op planning. Make sure you have ordered everything, like the kitchen sink, and everything is ready at the time of when you decide to do the surgery. Thank you.